were creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry and from north to south and east to west we hear cries be magnified.
We welcome you to another service today, and it's fantastic that you are able to join us. We know it's been a really tough ride, hasn't it been, for 14, even maybe 15 months? And folks have been actually watching online. It has been very, very successful. But we know that you are actually missing being in church. And Warren, there's good reason why we haven't had the formal services, the conventional services, given the circumstances. And I think that folks need to know the reasons why we've kept the church closed. Many churches have actually tried to open and had a quota system and what have you. People had to phone in to book seats. And we as a church never want to try to be like a theater and a movie house where you have to book a seat. And therefore, there's been good reason why we've kept the church closed. I know that many people have expressed concern, but you might have a good reason for making that decision along with your team.
Yeah, Bruce, it was a decision that was made, and we did inform our community right at the onset that we didn't want to have to open and close. There's a lot of effort that goes into that, so gearing up the church to being able to open. And then when the regulations change again, as they have through the various waves, then being forced to close again. And I think, we do a lot of services, so public ministry, in weddings and christenings, where it's outside venues. And when you see how difficult it is to manage and to regulate those protocols, the responsibility in an outside venue is not on us. But if we're going to meet as a church, the responsibility then transfers to us. And we become the watchdogs. We have to go and make sure. And the reality is that we would much rather have the safety of our people as a priority and be able to engage with them, find other ways, innovative ways, get everybody involved in caring for each other safely within their own circles. And that's difficult. Because it's uncomfortable for some to have to step out. It's a lot easier rather just to come to church. But I think there's a lot of growth there for our church members, and it's a safe environment for them to still have that community.
And of course, many of our people actually have these comorbidities as well that one has to take into consideration. So it would be recklessly irresponsible if we had to actually open the church like the normal services we used to have before COVID and have somebody go down with COVID. And we have quite a number of people in our church who've actually contracted COVID. And I think that it's a very, very wise call, but it's not a popular call because not everybody feels the same way. And they feel that unless they have that sort of human contact or social interaction, that it's not church. And we know that that is not true, because up to now we've actually emphasized the fact, even in your series, that we are the church, that it's not the building. However, that doesn't negate the fact that the Bible says we mustn't neglect the assembling of ourselves together. But not neglecting the assembling of ourselves together does not imply we must therefore have an assembly, but not be responsible enough to take precautionary steps. And that's basically what you've done. You've taken precautionary steps to actually look after our people. You've done that out of care and concern for what can actually happen. I know we even had to open the school, which was really a tough one. But we have the third spike that they are talking about. We actually are about to enter into winter, and we're going to expect quite a few folks that will in actual fact be more vulnerable than what they have been. So it's a tough one to be at home, but our folks have been very faithful. I mean, they've been fantastic. But obviously, folks talk to one another, but there's a church down the road that's actually opened, but that church has opened and closed and opened and closed. And we believe that inconsistency is not a good thing for our people. And we want to encourage them when they do actually go online, try to go online the time that we would normally have a service so that they stick to a routine. And it's not a shock when we do open the church. Oh boy, you remember we used to lie in bed watching church. Now we have to go back to church. It's not going to be such a big schlep for them. It's going to be something that everyone is looking forward to. And it's going to happen.
Yeah. Bruce, that human interaction is so necessary. And it's part of the way that God has designed us. So we're not saying don't have that interaction. But in whatever way, it needs to be safe. And that's why within your circles, do that. I've also looked at sports events, international, and they still have no spectators in the stadiums. And I'm saying, if that is what they are willing to do to ensure the safety of the people, then we need to care enough for our people to also be concerned about their safety.
Yes, and it's not having a lack of faith. And many people say, but we as a Christian church is unlike sporting organizations where they have to take those things into consideration. We as Christians should have enough of faith that God's going to protect us. Mm. But that is not so, because God has not immunized us against these challenges. Yeah. And therefore, we have to take those physical considerations and consider them, because if we don't, we are showing that we really are not a church that loves our people.
Faith should never be an excuse for being irresponsible.
Right.
And that is not what God would ever want to endorse or encourage.
Sure.
So, Bruce, and look, it's difficult. We would never have said, when lockdown started in 2020, we would never have thought we would be standing here today.
Sure.
Like this, so many months later, still projecting that we're not going to be opening for the next few months.
100%, because Jesus didn't go down to the leper colonies and spend an evening there. You know, they brought the lepers to him. He didn't go into the colony and say, well, there's so many of you that are sick, I'm going to spend time with you because you need spiritual help. No, he didn't do that, simply because he was responsible. And we need to actually be very responsible. That doesn't negate the fact that we understand that there's a spiritual dynamic. People are faced with spiritual challenges, and we're battling against forces that are way beyond flesh and blood, spiritual forces that are at work. And so I think that it's been fantastic and wise in the way that you've strategized and worked this out. And many people's lives have been wonderfully changed. We're actually reaching a lot more people who are online, overseas, et cetera, et cetera. And it's also given us an opportunity to relook at how you want to change the setting of the church when we are ready for the big opening. And that's going to be quite a service.
And that is exciting, and it's good to look forward to, giving us time to plan and then also to be able to address some of the other things we've always wanted to address in being able to communicate effectively in the congregation. So we are very excited about that.
Well, look at the feedback that I get from people is that they are greatly blessed and they really are appreciative of it. And yes, you do get some complaints and what have you, but we try to put into perspective, because some folks are still in denial. They deny that this is really happening.
Yeah.
And it's too close to home in that we have too many people that we know of and folks that are in our congregation that are down with COVID. Mm. And can you imagine how bad we would feel as leaders of the church if our members have contracted COVID because they came along to a service? Because you'd really don't know how you got it.
Yeah,
and you know, I went to church, and you have to be very careful going to church. Can you imagine how that would actually spiral out of control? And coming to church would be a negative, not a positive. We want to turn it into your positive.
Absolutely. Mm. So, Bruce, I think it's been brilliant being able to minister alongside you on this medium, and that, you know, for everybody to be able to see that spiritually we are still able to get that message across.
Oh, absolutely.
And I think that's the beauty of it. And the future is still uncertain, but we are certain as to the fact that God has a plan.
Yeah.
And that's really what we are following.
Yeah.
We're following His divine plan and being able to meet people's spiritual needs and encourage them where they are with whatever means we can.
And of course, people who choose not to hear what we are saying will say, but when are we going to open the church? Mm. Can you answer that?
I can't. Mm. Because that's how uncertain it is. We can't give a date. So as the vaccine rolls out, the regulations change, there's a third spike now, Europe is still going through their difficulties.
Yeah.
So can we give a definite date? Right now we can't. But we can definitely say that we are able to meet. And that is online for now. And
It's not the same.
It's not the same.
But it's a very, very good alternative
and
a good substitute. I think everybody's looking forward to seeing each other, you know, because besides coming to church and singing and worshiping with the Lord, it's actually seeing friends you haven't seen for a long, long time.
Mm.
And I think that folks are missing that type of dynamic. And we can look forward to when the church is open, that we will only open it when we believe that safety measures and protocols are put in place where we can actually protect our people.
Absolutely.
We want to assure you guys that we really love you and we're very, very concerned about you. And we're only doing this in your best interest. So please continue to pray, continue to support our program, and continue to bear Warren up as he leads the church into the future. that God will inspire him, give him wisdom, sensitivity, that he'll be able to fulfill what God has called him to fulfill. And I know they're all very, very proud of Warren. And let's continue to work together as believers and make a difference. Because St. Mark's has always been a church with a difference. And we want to make a big impact upon people's souls. Because an impression doesn't last very long. An impact lasts for eternity. So thank you, Warren. I think you've given a great explanation for why really we've had to make this decision.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Let's pray.
Thank you.
Lord, we know that although the future is uncertain, that you have never been caught by surprise. Mm. And so, Father, we know that each of our lives has been impacted in a great way because of what we're facing. A massive chunk of what was normal has been taken away by us not being able to gather. But, Father, thank you that that will never, ever stop your work. And so we pray that your work will continue in the lives of every single person who connects with our ministry, and that their lives will be a shining light in the world around them. We thank you for all that you continue to do and for all that we know is in your hands as we give you praise in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Keep yourself safe, please. Look after yourself now. God bless you all. We talk about the rapture, but do we really know what the rapture is? The rapture is a very interesting English word, and we have it in our Bibles. Or do we? Some Bibles might have it, but a lot of Bibles don't have the word rapture. You won't find the word rapture generally in the scriptures, but neither do you have the word Trinity. The word rapture is really taken from a Latin word. And the Greek word used in the New Testament, from which we get our English, is in actual fact the word harpazo. And that word simply means a snatching away. It is used, very interesting, it is actually used when God, in the book of Acts, where God actually translates Philip, and he snatches Philip away. The same word harpazo is used there as Philip being taken from one area to another in order to fulfill God's purpose. The writer to the believers and the Christians in Corinth and in Thessalonica uses that word to express a secret that has never been revealed to anyone before. You and I, as Christians, have a blessed hope, a hope that is beyond, if not out of this world. A hope that God has promised that through the trying times in which we go, before the great tribulation occurs, God is going to take us out and God is going to take us home. That is what the rapture is. It precedes the 7 years of tribulation. Now, if we get back into the Old Testament, as well as the promises in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will find that the Jewish mind was different about an eternal hope. You and I have a heavenly hope. The Jews saw their hope as the resurrection of their body and for them to enjoy life here on this planet. This was their so-called heaven. And therefore, from a Jewish perspective, even to this day, Jews acknowledge the fact that their spirit returns to God and the body goes into the grave, and they're going to wait for the resurrection of the dead. That was their hope. You and I have a hope that is greater than the Jewish hope, because our hope is not merely physical. It is spiritual. And it is in light of that today that we want to consider our blessed hope. I'll be presenting this talk in two parts. The rapture, our blessed hope. And today in this first part, we're going to consider the fact that whilst the Jewish people anticipated living on this planet for the rest of their life, especially after they're resurrected from the dead, they're going to reign with their Messiah, and there's going to be a kingdom on earth. That was the Jewish expectation. After all, the entire ministry of Jesus, in his earthly ministry, he emphasized the fact that the kingdom of God was at hand. And that would indicate that the Jews could look forward to the resurrection of the dead, which meant a tremendous amount to them as a nation, because they had gone through so much turmoil. Many, many nations had actually reaped havoc amongst the nation of Israel. But they were looking forward to a time when God would resurrect them. Remember in Ezekiel's dry bones, will these bones live again? It's talking about Israel. And they will live again. They will live again. They will rise from the dead. Even Job writes and he says, in my flesh, I will see God. He anticipates in his resurrection that God will give him an immortal body, that he will be able to see the Lord. What was Job talking about? What was the psalmist David speaking about? What were the prophets speaking about? Their focus was earthly, looking for the resurrection where they would live for eternity on planet Earth. Our hope is not earthly. Our hope is a spiritual one. Our hope is heavenly. And it is in that regard that 1 Corinthians 15, 51 through to 57 says the following. Behold, I tell you a mystery. I'm going to share with you a secret. Many people say, well, that secret was the resurrection. Yes and no. Because it was more than the resurrection. This was something that God was showing as a secret, that it's not only our physical bodies that will be resurrected, but that when we who die go straight into the presence of God. You see, from the Jewish Old Testament perspective, when a person died, they could not go into the realms of heaven, but they would go to a place of waiting. The New Testament makes reference to this as Abraham's bosom, a place of waiting. But when Jesus rose from the dead, he emptied that abode. He emptied it with the souls of those who were anticipating their resurrection. He emptied it and he transported it where? To heaven. So when we speak of paradise today, we're not speaking about it being earthly. We're speaking about a very special heavenly place in the realms of the heavenlies, as the Bible teaches. So it says, not all of us are going to sleep, but we will all be changed. Some will die, and they will go to be with the Lord, their spirit and their soul. But some of us will go through a change. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the very last trump. You see, whenever the Bible uses the word trumpet, it's speaking about God's special call, his final call for the church. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible and shall be changed. For this corruptible body must put on incorruption, and this mortal body must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O hell, or Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us a victory over death through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So you can see now that Christ has died and he's ascended into heaven, that when we die, we're going to be with the Lord. In the Old Testament, that wasn't anticipated. It was having to wait for the resurrection. You see, often the Christian church mingles the resurrection with the rapture and gets terribly confused. And therefore, we need to know that the rapture does include a resurrection, but it includes the resurrection of the body of Christ. Christians who have died and gone to heaven, they will come back with him. They will come back with him to receive their physical body. To point this out, let us consider 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through to 18. This is what he says. I do not want you to be ignorant. In other words, I want you to be aware of this concerning those who have fallen asleep, those who are resting their souls and spirits in the presence of God. Lest you sorrow, you go through grief as others who have no hope. For if we believe, this is a beautiful one, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him, who's him? Jesus. Those who sleep. Where? In the ground? In the dust? No, in Jesus. So when the Lord has gone to heaven, he's made it possible for us. He's created a passageway so that when we die, we leave our physical bodies, we go straight to his presence. But we're going to come back for the rapture, and we're going to come back to receive a immortal body. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain, those who haven't died, and the coming of the Lord, the rapture takes place, will by no means precede those who have died, those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, a great call, and the dead in Christ will rise first. So the body, the corrupted body, is now going to take on incorruption. Now, I know many people have the question, and that is, what about those who died at war, those who were buried out at sea? What happens about those who are cremated? God does not require one single atom to recreate an immortal body. Then we who are alive and haven't yet died shall be caught up together with them. Who's them? Our loved ones who've already taken on the immortal body. And we will meet where? On earth? No, in the clouds. We'll meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. And then the writer says, comfort one another with these words. That's the blessed hope. The blessed hope is that although we die physically, we do not die personally. We will one day, however, come back at the rapture to receive our physical body. And then we find that the writer goes on in the very next chapter of 1 Thessalonians 4, in chapter 5, he says the following from verse 4 through 11. But you, brothers and sisters, you're not in darkness, so that this day, what day? The coming of the Lord will surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night, neither are we in darkness concerning the coming of the Lord. So then let us not be like others who are sleeping. And here he's talking about physical, mental, psychological sleeping, not being aware, unaware of the times in which you live. But let us be awake and let us be sober, for those who sleep, sleep at the night. Now he's not talking about those who've died. He's talking about people here who actually are people of darkness. They haven't accepted the light, which is the glorious gospel. And those who get drunk, when do they get drunk? Usually at night. But since we belong to the day, let us not be drunk. Let us be sober. Let us put on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God, listen to this, for God did not appoint us to suffer what? Wrath. That word wrath there is judgment. God has not designed us or the body of Christ, Christians, to face judgment. The nation of Israel is going to face judgment in the 7 years of tribulation. They're going to face the wrath of God. But God hasn't designed the Christian church, the body of Christ, to suffer that judgment. And that's one of the crucial verses to support the belief that the rapture takes place before the 7 years of tribulation. And therefore, we are not designed to suffer wrath, but to receive what? Salvation. Now, that salvation is talking about the physical salvation. We've already been saved spiritually. We've already been saved personally. But there will come a time when we will be saved from eternal death by virtue of the fact that we'll be resurrected from the dead when God's Spirit brings with Jesus those spirits and souls of loved ones who have died before us. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, if we are living or we have died, we live together with him. Notice what it says. We live together with him. Even those who sleep in Christ, they are living because they are resting, but they're still alive. And therefore, brothers, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Now, that's why this message is important. It's a message of great comfort to you. Those of you that have lost loved ones, those of you that are questioning your own mortality, we're living in a time where COVID is rampant and people closer and closer to us are losing their life. And even young people's lives are being shortened. They're dying prematurely because of the incredible scourge of COVID. We can take comfort in the fact that if we leave our physical body, we have a home with God. Our soul and our spirit goes to be with the Lord. The real you, the real me, is your personality. And therefore, the day will come when the rapture takes place that we're going to come back first to receive our bodies. And then directly after that, people who are still alive will be snatched away in the great apozo, the great parousia, which is a lovely Greek word. The word parousia in Greek simply means an appearance, the great appearance of Christ. Where does he meet us? On earth? No. He meets us in the air. And that is the secret that the writer to the Corinthians was trying to explain to them. I'm not talking to you merely about the resurrection of the dead. I'm presenting to you a secret that has never been revealed. And that secret is that some of us are not going to die. We're going to be caught away to meet the Lord in the air. So my friends, this belief in the rapture is what really purifies your hope, or should I say keeps you focused. You know, often we lose focus, we get tired, we become exhausted, we lose focus of the purpose of why God has saved us. But what happens if we consciously, on a regular basis, remember that the Lord could come at any time. There's no prophecy that needs to be fulfilled for the rapture. It can happen at any time. It could have happened 1,000 years ago, but it's getting closer, very much closer, as we see the times and the seasons in which we live. Now God is beginning to put into place new role players on the stage of life. And that is, he's preparing the nation of Israel for what we know is the tribulation. But we're going to be snatched away. Again, I repeat, because we have not been called or designed for God's judgment. We will escape that judgment. Many people say, well, that is an escape mentality. What is salvation? What does the word salvation mean? It means to be saved from any calamity. So yes, call it a rescue if you wish. The Lord is going to rescue us. And therefore, don't allow your heart to fail you. Don't allow your faith to waver. Don't allow yourself to be captured by the affairs of the world. Remember, the day of the Lord is drawing near. And therefore, 2 Corinthians 5:8 is a crucial verse. Please write it down. 2 Corinthians 5:8. We are confident. Yes, we are even well pleased rather to be absent from this physical body and to be present with the Lord. Therefore, the word parousia in Greek means the appearance of our Savior. The great parousia, the great appearance. He's coming back again. And in my second part to this two-part series on the blessed hope, I'm going to cover the greatest spectacular event that will take place in human history, and that is the day that that final trump sounds, where people will vanish all over the world. And therefore, that is God's parousia. The apocalypse is in actual fact the time when God reveals to the nation of Israel and fulfills his promise of the resurrection. We don't have to worry about that. We are not looking for the final chapters of the Revelation. We are looking at the sound of the trumpet when we will be snatched away before the 7 years of tribulation. So my friend, next week you're going to have to buckle up, get ready, because we're going to look at this most dramatic event in human history that will change the whole landscape of the world forever. I believe in the rapture. I hope you do. And if you do, you can look forward to the greatest event in human history. God bless you all, and thank you for giving your time and attention to this very important subject, the blessed hope of the Christian.